What if love was a context? A space, a clearing in which life shows up. What if love was a stand? A declaration. What if you were your word and you said, I love you to somebody? But suppose you didn't feel like it. Suppose you said, I love you to somebody, but you didn't feel it. Well, I'll tell you what. See, for most people, they've identified themselves as their feelings. Now, if you are your feelings, then we can produce a you with a few chemicals. There's damn near no feeling you can't produce with a chemical today. So if you are your feelings, first off, you don't have feelings. Feelings have you. See, feel happy right now. Or feel something other than what you're feeling right now. See, if you're having feelings, then you ought to be able to have whatever feeling you want to have. Now, I say that feelings are having you. You are this thing which shows up in your feelings and thoughts. You don't think, thoughts you. That thing you call myself shows up in your thinking and in your feeling. And it's something over which you have absolutely no control. If you are thinking, you stop doing that. No, you are not thinking. Because if you were thinking, you could stop. See, I'm speaking. And I can stop. Let's see you stop thinking. No, it is thinking. And you show up in its thoughts. It thinks you. You don't think it. It feels you. You don't feel it. You don't feel. You show up in your feelings. And our relationships are a product of that kind of mechanism for the most part, because you and I are committed that we are our feelings and we are our thoughts. And particularly in the area of relationships, if you say something you don't feel, you know it's not true. Y'all are trapped. I think we ought to go home. This is a bad deal. It's hopeless. You have no power to create. Really? Particularly in a relationship, you cannot bring forth that which you don't feel and think and believe. How about creating for yourself a possibility of being your word in your relationships? You see, if who you are is not your feelings and not your thoughts, even though it's true that you have feelings and thoughts, but if who you are is your word, which you can give. And which you can withhold giving, while you cannot withhold thinking, while you cannot withhold feeling. Things trigger feelings. Things trigger thoughts. But if who you are is your word, if who you are in a relationship is your word, then you can create love in a relationship by the declaration, I love you, where I love you is not a matter of sincerity like it represents some feeling inside of you, but a matter of validity like something for which you are willing to stand. Where the stand is a context for life of the relationship to show up in. If who you are is your word, and you can give and not give your word, then you can create love in your relationships by simply saying so as a stand for that, for love, where the stand is a clearing in which the stuff of the relationship shows up. I'm going to tell you a story, and I hope I can tie it back to why I'm telling you the story. Sometimes I forget in the process of telling the story. There was once a caliph who was possessed by a strange desire. That's strange, at least for a caliph. This caliph was possessed by a desire for scientific knowledge. And so he called in to his desert oasis the wisest man of that country. And he said, I want to know on what the earth stands. And the caliph said, Commander of the faithful, this is a very difficult question, but being a man of science who's devoted his whole life to study, I know the answer. The earth is the back of a giant turtle floating in a great bowl of water. And now the caliph, whose curiosity was very much aroused, said to the wise men, yes, but on what does that bowl stand? And the wise men answered, Commander of the faithful, this is an extremely difficult question. In fact, in the whole world, I am the only one who knows the answer to that question. As I said, the earth is the back of a giant turtle floating in an enormous bowl. And that bowl stands on the back of a white elephant with golden tusks. But, Commander of the faithful, on what that elephant stands, nobody knows. Just a moment ago, I was provoking you. I was provoking you with the possibility of real power in your relationships. The power that comes from being willing to live in your relationship as your word, not devoid or ignoring your feelings, but where your word becomes a context for your feelings, not devoid of your thoughts or considerations, but where your word becomes a context for your thoughts and considerations. I was inviting you, provoking you, that you could create deep, profound love when you were willing to live as your word by declaring your love, where the declaration was a stand for love as a clearing for the stuff in the relationship to show up in. The thing of why I told you the story was that I want to bring the two together, and where I want to bring them together is in that existential act of being willing to be your word. There is no reason for the commitment to live as your word in your relationship. There's no explanation for it. There's no prize for doing so. It's an act of existential courage. It is like stepping out too far over a cliff. What takes you out there is the stepping out. No matter what you are thinking, the universe does not move for your thoughts. As you step out over the precipice, the universe does not move for your thoughts. It does not move for your feelings. The universe cares nothing about your fear. It only cares about stepping out. The universe cares nothing about why you stepped out or what you hope to get out of it. The universe will move only for stepping out. This ability to create in your relationships, to live as your word, to create clearings in which your relationship can show up, is an existential act of courage. It is simply in the doing so that it happens. Not in the explanation, not in the justification, not in the rationalization, but in the deed itself. Living as your word, when one lives as their word, there is no doer, there is only the deed. The brutally difficult phenomenon with which to come to grips. You see, we live in this myth of the doer. I thought, I felt, the reason I, why I, and never recognize that the stars don't move for the doer, only for the deed. When you are willing to live as your word, you have transformed yourself into the deed. You are no longer the doer, but the deed. The declaration, I love you. Showing up as a stand, which becomes a clearing in which the relationship can appear, is a pure deed. There is no doer. Love is created in the moment of saying so, like a stand. And for that act, there is no help. You see, on what the elephant stands, nobody knows. It's up to you like a deed. Are you willing to take the stand that you are the stand you take? When you do, you transform yourself from the doer to the deed. Are you willing to give your word that you are your word? Because in the giving of your word, you become your own word like a transformation. See, I've been preparing for this event about relationships, and I've looked all over for a relationship. I cannot find one. I've looked in people's houses. I've looked in people's nurseries. I've looked in the back seat of people's cars. And I've never found a relationship. I cannot find a relationship, and yet when I go to the library, there are books and books and books and books on relationship. And you think you've got one. Some of you think you're sitting next to it. But there isn't any such thing as a relationship. A relationship is a space of possibility, an opening. It's like a possibility. And what shows up in that possibility is a product of the domain in which you hold that possibility. So again, I want you to see, I'm going someplace. I want you to see first, though, that there is no such thing as a relationship. You can't show me a relationship. See, your 20 or 30 or 50 years together is not a relationship. No, there's no such thing as a relationship. A relationship is a space of possibility, an opening for things to show up in. See, I like you shows up in a relationship. If you don't have any relationship, there's no place for I like you to show up. It's a space, it's a clearing, not a thing. I don't like you. Can't have any I don't like you with no relationship. A relationship is not a thing, it's a space of possibility. The quality of what shows up in that space of possibility is dependent on the domain in which that space of possibility rests. Now, I know it's a long sentence, so I'll say it again. First off, there's no such thing as a relationship. If you go looking all around, you'll never find a relationship. You may find people together, but you won't necessarily find a relationship. When people are together. No, there's no such thing as a relationship. It's a space of possibility. It's like an opening or a clearing, and things show up in that space of possibility. Things show up in that clearing. Things show up in that opening. In that opening, love can show up. I like can show up. I don't like you can show up. Many things can show up. Satisfaction can show up. Dissatisfaction can show up. Many things can show up. Any circumstance you can think of probably can show up in that space of possibility which relationship actually is. I say the quality of what shows up is determined by the domain in which the possibility relationship lives for you. If your relationship is like a story, like a this happened and then that happened, then I thought this and then she did that, and then I felt this and so on and so forth, if that's the domain in which the possibility of relationship lives for you, then you will have that quality of relationship which is commensurate with that domain, the narrative, story, soap opera domain. And the soap opera may be very beautiful. The poetry is full of it. I told you I had distilled the wisdom of the ages. I wasn't going to read it to you, but there's one I do want to read to you. Bear with me. Oh, yes. This is André Malraux. We owe to the Middle Ages the two worst inventions of humanity, romantic love and gunpowder. So, you know, in the poetry, in the myths, in the fables, there's all these wonderful relationships which live like a story and which enthrall small children before they go to bed. And others. So I'm not saying that your relationship will be good or bad. If the possibility of relationship lives for you like a story, I'm simply saying that you are limited to what you can get out of the domain of story and narrative, out of the domain of history, or projection into the future. I was thinking about doing a process with you tonight. And you can do the process while I'm talking about it if you like, to give you a chance to discover the distinction between anybody with whom you are related, and it really can be anybody, to discover the distinction with that person to whom you are related between really your experience of them and the way they show up for you like a bunch of considerations. I was in India, in Bombay, doing a workshop with executives. And the workshop went over 4 or 5 days, and one of the executive's daughters was being married. And he came in one day after we'd been talking about some of this kind of stuff. Obviously, it was different. You don't talk about relationships in business. To executives, at least. And he stood up to share, and he said, my wife and I were discussing our daughter's marriage, and, you know, she has her own views about it, and I have my own views about it. And I was thinking, you are really pushy about his wife. She was really pushy. And then he realized that what was actually true is that he has the interpretation that his wife is really pushy. And what actually showed up in his experience was his wife saying whatever came out of her mouth. You see, what is that she said whatever came out of her mouth. His consideration is that she's pushy. when he had to deal with a pushy woman, he dealt in one way. When he had to deal with a woman who said whatever she said, he dealt in a totally different way. I'll let you guess about which one was more effective.